softly claps its wings.
Tell her again.
Alexa, she's mad. Alexa, can you put sugar on my grocery list? She is not going to answer me.
Alexa, stop. Now do it.
Alexa, can you put sugar on my grocery list?
I couldn't find a list called grocery.
Shopping
Should
list.
Should I create one?
Yes.
Okay.
I've created grocery list and added sugar to it.
Okay, thank you.
All right, good morning, everybody. For those that don't know me, my name is Lance Green, and it's an honor today to welcome you to the memorial service of our dear sister, Geraldine Wilkinson, affectionately known by many, maybe most in this room, as Nana. The wise man wrote, he said, "To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance." Those that are familiar with the portion of Scripture, you know it continues on for several more verses. But verse 11, the writer captured these words: "He hath made everything beautiful in His time." You see, by design, God has chosen life to be encircled in seasons. And these seasons seem to stand in contrast to one another. It's a duality, or some may call it a dichotomy at times, where we find ourselves in the middle of these seasons. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up that which was planted. And here today we find ourselves in the middle of such a season, and yet we come together on this day to remember the life of Nana, a life that has passed on from this world, a life that you could say has been plucked from its planting today. But remember that He has made everything beautiful in His time. Few things are more beautiful than a life worth or well lived, a life lived in the pursuit of Christ, a life that is lived in faithfulness to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He has made all things beautiful in His time. Would you bow your heads today as we open in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank You for the life of Geraldine Wilkinson, and for the opportunity to gather today in her memory. We acknowledge that You chose her from the foundations of the world, and having predestined to adopt her into Your family through Jesus Christ, we pray today that as the curtain of her memory is rolled back, that each of us would once again feel the imprint of her life upon our life. A life that was well lived, a life that was rooted in Christ Jesus, a life that even in the frailty of her final days, her clearest moments were those in prayer. Father, for 89 years, You've heard her prayers.
prayers that were lifted over the years for many, if not for all, in this room today. She prayed over us for our healing. She prayed for our provision. She prayed for deliverance. She prayed for salvation. And you revealed to her so many times your faithfulness and showing her the answer to those prayers. And yet today, we recognize that many of those prayers have been offered up as a memorial before you. And I believe today, Lord, that even as she has passed from this earth, that you are not complete in the fulfillment of answered prayers that she has offered to you. There are people here today who will continue to experience the miracle of answered prayers in their life because of the many prayers that she has prayed over them in her lifetime. Finally, Lord, we ask that your Spirit would fill this room. Let it stretch across the miles to those that are watching online today. We pray, be the strength of our hearts today. We pray, be near to those that are of a broken heart. We pray that you would comfort those who mourn. For your word says, now is your time of grief, but I will see you again and you will rejoice. And no one will take your joy away. For we look with anticipation today toward a day that is coming soon, where your word says God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there will be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. Neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. We thank you today, Father, for your loving arms of care, for comfort and of compassion. As you help us move through our grief today, as we turn our eyes again to that glorious hope that we all have today. That hope that says we which are alive and remain shall be caught up to meet them. And we'll be reunited with Nana, Papa, with many others that are dead in Christ. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. We pray in this service today that those words and many others would comfort the family, the friends that have gathered here today. In your name, amen. Amen. We invite today the grandchildren to come to sing. And Dylena, Brenna, and Andon have prepared a song. Would you worship the Lord today as they sing?
There's coming a day when no heartaches shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye, and all is peace forevermore on that what a day, glorious day that will be. And what a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. And when he takes me by the hand and leads me to that promised land, what There'll be no sorrows there, no more burdens to bear, no more sickness, no pain, no more parting of the day. And forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, a glorious day that will be.
Sing it with us.
What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me to promised land. What a day, a glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me to that promised land. What a day, glorious day that will be. And what a day, glorious day that will be. What a day, a glorious day that will be.
I'm gonna do my best to get through this. Geraldine Wilkinson, born July 18th, 1934. She was born in Leech, Oklahoma, to parents Vivian and Dortha Hopper. When she was born, her birth certificate simply read, Hopper baby. Back then, they just went with that. She didn't have a name yet. She didn't receive a proper birth certificate until 1985. She was the eldest of five children. Her brothers and sister were Dale, Jean, Shirlene, and Ron. The family left Oklahoma following the availability of work and eventually ended up in California, first in Mojave, and then later in the Goshen-Visalia area where they settled in. Her teen years were in Goshen, California, where they settled, and her family, along with Reverend W.H. Garrett, was instrumental in helping the founding of Mount Zion Apostolic Church, which was started in Vivian and Dortha's renovated chicken coop. On this day of her homegoing service, November 11th, in 1951, at age of 17, she married a young man from the neighboring church, James Wilkinson. They had three children, Brenda, Darla, and Jimmy Darrell. And they settled into a family life in Goshen, California. In 1964, they suffered a tragedy when Jimmy Darrell was diagnosed with leukemia and passed away at the age of 2. This took a lot of adjustment for the family, but with God's help, they continued on. And then came the grandkid years. Brenda had married John Gregory at first. Shanna came along, then Starla came into their lives. Later, Darla married Andrew Dillon, which I'm very grateful for, because they added Dylena, Brenna, and then, of course, Grandma's favorite, me. That wasn't actually in there, but I thought it was important. When all of her grandkids and kids ended up in the north, she was heading north and relocated to Washington State, and that was just going to be that. James didn't have much of a choice, although I don't think he would have chosen anything else. They helped in founding the Chilliwack Church, this very church, the First Church of Pentecost, and were members here for the rest of their lives. She is predeceased by her son, Jimmy Darrell, and husband, James, her brothers, Dale, Jean, and Ron. And she is survived by daughters Brenda and John, Darla and Andrew, grandchildren Shanna, Starla, Dalina, Brenna, and me, Andon. 12 great-grandchildren and one great-great-grandchild. If she and James had lived to this day, it would have been their 73rd wedding anniversary. I almost said 71, but its 73rd wedding anniversary would have been today. She had lived a blessed life. She had lived a life of faith in Jesus Christ her entire life. And she now lives in the presence of the Lord and Savior and the countless loved ones that preceded her.
Thank you, Andon. Would you stand together today? We're on the back of your handout today is the lyrics to the song that we're going to sing together. Brother Brandon's going to lead. And when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. I'll be there.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair. When the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there. Let us labor for the Master from the dawn till setting sun. Let us talk of all his wondrous love and care. Then when all of life is over and our work on earth is done, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, 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 I'll be there.
You just thank him for that promise today, that hope that we have in Christ Jesus. Oh, we thank you. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. You can be seated again. It was 1856 in South Hill, New York, where a man by the name of James Milton Black was born, and in his early years, he acquired a musical education and was very proficient in singing and the playing of the organ. In his early 20s, he relocated to Williamsport, Pennsylvania, where he began to serve at the Methodist Episcopal Church. Black was a very zealous young man for Jesus Christ. His days were filled in not only the writing of music, but the editing of hymnals. He taught Sunday school and youth class, and passionate about Jesus Christ and the testimony of his Lord and Savior, he would wander the streets looking for young people that he could testify to. On one particular day in a dark alley, he met a 14-year-old girl, and upon learning her story, found out that she was the daughter of an alcoholic father and a mother who had already passed. And
sensing an opportunity to witness to her, she soon began attending Sunday school in his class on Sundays. And in the custom of that day, or at least in Black's classroom, he would take attendance each Sunday, and he would start from the top in an alphabetical order, would work his way down the list. And on this particular Sunday, when he got to her name, he called her name, and he did not hear a response. The accurate response in his class was that a child would stand and quote their favorite Bible verse to indicate their presence in the classroom. And so he called her name a second time and now began to search the rows, a third time calling for her. She failed to answer. And so, disturbed by her absence, quickly after Sunday, he found his way to her home and, knocking on the door, learned quickly that she had contracted pneumonia. And in the late 1800s, by this point, with no medicine available, that young girl passed quickly because of her illness. And knowing of the service that would follow soon in the local church, Black went home, and he was a songwriter. He was a song leader, a worship leader, kind of like Papa James was a worship leader. And he searched the hymnals that he was editing and had edited in the past, looking frantically for a hymn that would articulate this idea of a roll call. You see, in his classroom on earth, when he called her name on that Sunday, she was absent. But he was looking for words in a hymn that could comfort those that came to mourn. And when he couldn't find an adequate song, the story says that within 15 minutes, all the lyrics to the song we just sang were downloaded into his spirit. Not only the lyrics, but the melody and the chords all came to him instantly. And as feverishly as he could capture that with pen on paper, James Milton Black captured the words to the song, "When the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there." Friends, today we don't understand all of what happens after death. We look, as the writer said, through a glass darkly. We know the hope and we know the end state of the believer. But the process in how we get there and when it all transpires is somewhat uncertain. But what I can tell you today is when that book of life is opened and the words, the names are read in perhaps alphabetical order, I'm not sure how it'll happen, but I see it as somewhere in the book of life when our Savior gets to the letter G. There's a confidence in me that comes from witnessing the life of Geraldine that says, I know with a certainty that her name is written in that book of life. And as that little girl was absent on that Sunday, wasn't able to respond to the calling of her name, that may be the case if we were to take a call today of the roll. Geraldine wouldn't be in this room, in this place, in her physical body. But the Bible does say to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And somewhere on that great getting up morning, when the seals to the books are opened and the roll is called up yonder, the name Geraldine Wilkinson will be there. And she will respond to the call of her name. Not just any roll call, but the roll call of Jesus Christ, her Savior, the one who forgave her of her sins, the one in whose name she was baptized, the one in whom she rejoiced in her new life, that she was filled with the gift of the Holy Spirit. Can I just tell you today, the family of God takes comfort in knowing that her name is written in that book of life. And when her name is called, the words to follow will be, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, and I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord." Can I just close with this today? My comments in the 25 years or so, maybe a little bit longer, that I knew Nonna, I searched for a word that would encapsulize the Nonna that I knew, and the only word that really seems suffice is faithful. Faithful. Oh, and Dailena and I were, back then, maybe it was still called courting, I don't know. But when we were seeing each other, and she'd take me over to her Nonna and Papa's house, and we'd ride scooters down to the corner store and have lots of fun, and Papa would burn things he's not supposed to burn in the backyard, and it was just a good time. But can I tell you, as sure as we'd have fun and enjoy company with them, Nonna, Papa would prepare, Nonna would prepare dinner, and then somewhere after dinner, they'd disappear. And from the back bedroom, you'd hear the prayers so often of Papa and Nonna praying. Can I tell you today, there's few things that I seek to strive for in my life other than just simply the faithfulness of God, or towards God, a faithfulness in my life. I hope that when my life is over, those that may remember me would remember, or could remember me in a similar way. It's the striving of my life to be as faithful to the Lord as Geraldine was to her Lord. Faithfulness. There's a few more comments that came in today that I want to read on behalf of some that couldn't be here and others that couldn't be up here. Let me share some of what they've written today. This is from Shanna, her granddaughter. My grandma loved her grandkids like no one else. Though her last few years were dulled by a failing mind, I will always remember her as the sharpest tool in the family shed. If there was something I couldn't remember, I'd just call Grandma. If I needed to be reminded of an event or an appointment, she would call me, and she'd say, "Shanna, don't forget." And then she'd follow up with a phone call later to see how it went. Her level head and presence of mind gave me an immense sense of security in the darkest times of my life. Her love for Maris and I was completely unconditional, and if anyone ever spoke out against us, she was always in our corner ready to fight if needed. Grandma never once judged me or said a critical word, and I always sensed that in her heart, she felt concern for us. And losing her is a huge loss. And though I've cried many tears this past week, I'm happy for her, because I truly believe that she is free from her anguish and today is together with Jesus, with Grandpa, and with Jimmy Darrell. And while gravity will still hold us to this chaotic and frightening world, it no longer has a claim to Grandma. And someday soon we will see her again. Aren't you thankful for that hope today? Tanya's here today, and I'm reading on behalf of her. Tanya, you were such a blessing to the family in the final years, being a caretaker, and all we have to say is Talia. That's all we really have to say. the joy that that girl brings into any room is precious. And she brought a lot of that joy to Nan in the last few years. And here's what Tanya wrote. She said, Hello, I'm Tanya, Nana's girl. She did not always remember my name, but she knew exactly who I was. Talia and I got to spend 2.5 years with her. Nana always had a smile on her face. And I remember when we started coming to the church here that she would turn around with a big smile and wave at us. Oh, I remember every time that door opened, Nana on the second row would turn and smile. Turn to see with an inquisitive look who was here. And so I remember that, Tanya, as you penned those words. You said here, I remember the great times going to the park and then to Timmy's for coffee and donuts, and even just sitting with her at the house and having a good time. The best thing I'll always remember about her is that she always prayed and even worshiped, even in her confusion. That's one great thing I've learned from Nana, is to always pray and always worship the Lord no matter what. I'm grateful for Talia and for myself to have been a part of her life for the past 2.5 years. And I am comforted in the thought that we will meet again. Love you, Nana. We will miss you. My wife's going to come, followed by her brother, Andon, again, with comments, personal comments about Nana.
My husband and I did not confer on our notes today, and they may seem similar, but we did not even speak about it. So today, when thinking about Grandma, so many things I could say, so many memories I could share, because we spent, as children, we spent an incredible amount of time with them. Shopping trips, I never left a mall without my favorite thing or the thing that I needed most in that moment. Every blazer as a child, every little popple or the newest toy that came out, it was mine. If I just looked at it, Grandma would purchase it. She would see the longing in my eye, and that thing became mine and was in the bag before we left the store. I think about the road trips we took together, so much fun. I remember she didn't make us wear our seatbelt back in the day, so that was fun. we even slept on the floorboard of the car and the truck and all the way down to Disneyland, I believe. I remember Grandpa leading and Grandma's alto singing, and I can remember one particular time in a red car driving to church, Grandma and Grandpa singing, "I wouldn't take nothing for my journey now." How incredible those memories are. And yet the thing that impacted my life the most is having a grandma that prayed. It didn't matter what we were doing, and it didn't matter how much fun we were having. At bedtime, it was always time to pray. And it didn't matter if we wanted to join or we didn't want to join. In any point in our life, we were going to pray. And you better be there, and you better at least act like you're praying. It was never a quick prayer meeting. As a child, it felt sometimes incredibly long. It was a full-blown prayer meeting. It wasn't just a, now I lay me down to sleep sort of prayer. As a child, I didn't realize how much this memory would impact me. There were times I'd sit there and wonder why we needed to sit here so long. And then I would begin to listen to the prayers, because as a child, my prayer couldn't go that long. I couldn't pray that long. And so I would listen, and without fail, every one of our family members' names would be mentioned. And when my name came up, my ears would always perk up. I don't remember necessarily the words that she prayed, but I remember the feeling. And as a child, I remember that the prayers she prayed sometimes convicted me, but mostly those prayers inspired me. They made me want to do better, to be better, and it called me to do more. The last time I was with her, 2 weeks before she passed, I was in the hospital and my mom had left the room. and I just turned on some good gospel music that I knew she would love. And I thought, I'm going to pray for you because all these years you prayed for me. And I prayed for her, and I said, Grandma, I'm just going to pray. And we had a great little prayer, and the funny thing is she hadn't made much sense the whole time I was there. And as clear as could be, she began to pray, and it made the most sense of anything she had said in the last couple of years, and she just said, I love you, Jesus. Today, when I think of Grandma, I just think faithful. I think faithful to God. I think faithful to her husband, thankful to her family, and faithful to her family, and faithful in prayer. As a grandchild, I appreciate her example of faithfulness. This morning, I was reading my Bible, and it says this. I went to Hebrews 11 because I was thinking about Grandma's faithfulness. In Hebrews 11 and verse 1, it says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. And this verse says, for by it the elders obtained a good report. And when I think of Grandma, I think today she has earned and obtained her good report. I'm thankful for the life she lived. I'm thankful for her faithfulness. It inspires me. It encourages me to be faithful. Faithful to my God, faithful to my husband, faithful to my family, and faithful in prayer.
I'm going to be a little less serious than Di, but many people throughout my life have called me a brat. And if you ever have or thought it, 50% at least of that reason was because of Nana, because she spoiled me rotten. When I was growing up, Papa had one grandson. He worked a tough job, and he was so happy. When I was 11 years old, I worked my first job with Papa, and Nana, even though I was there for like probably 2 hours, Nana made sure he brought us lunch in the middle. She drove down and brought us lunch, and we did all that kind of stuff. And I, at 11 years old, I was grossly overpaid. By the time I was 13, I was being paid $15 US an hour, and at the time, that was almost $20 Canadian. And when I'd get home from work, Grandma would say, did your papa yell at you? And usually I would say, well, yeah, I'm being honest. He always yelled. And Papa was, he was just harder at work. And my grandpa would always say, well, Geraldine, now, I already told him, I'm going to give him an extra hour. She says, no, you're going to give him two because you don't treat your grandson like that. And I was, no, Nana, it's okay, it's okay. She's like, no, he's paying you, and that's okay. He's just going to do it. And that was just Nana. She was even with Papa, she was the first to defend us. And it was, like Dalina said, you know, I lived with them-ish every summer because I was working for Papa from the time I was probably about 12, 13, really mostly full-time in the summer, until I was about 18 when I started having other jobs. And no matter how much they paid me, if I say, Grandma, I think I want to ride my moped. Yes, I illegally rode a moped because they bought me one when I was like 13. And I want to ride it up to the store. And I was just, wait, give me a second. I'm going to get you $5. Or let me go get you. Is $5 enough? And like, they've been paying me all summer. But that's just the way she was. She just, you're at my house. I'm paying for everything. I'm taking care of you. And she would overpay us to clean her house, to do anything. She just, that's the way Nana was. Nana loved her family. And she loved her people. Now, you didn't have to be blood related to be Nana's family. Many of you here know that. And if you were one of her people, you were just family. I know for a fact, Bev would 100% be called family. In fact, I remember her being so excited when she found out that Misty was distantly related to one of her cousins or grandpas. Misty's grandpa was, somehow, she was so excited that Brandon married somebody that she was distantly related to, because that just meant more family. And that's just really who Nana was. It was, family was really, really important to her. Being her only grandson, I always like to tease the other grandkids that I was the favorite. But I still think I am. But for their sake today, I'll pretend that it was equal. I always said she had four granddaughters to spread the love around equally, and then one grandson. So I got 50%, and they each got, you know, a quarter of 50%, whatever's left. I'm not good at math. But throughout all of everything, in the last few years, I was thinking about what did Nana, like, she, for many of you know, she lost a lot of her memory. And even still, sometimes when she would see me, I could tell she couldn't figure out why Andon was a full-grown man. And sometimes she couldn't figure out why I had a wife and kids because I'm still a little boy in her mind. But she didn't forget her people, and she didn't forget that she loved Jesus. There were some things that were so ingrained in her mind, even through dementia. It didn't matter. Jesus was always something that was just in her brain. It was always. I remember going over to Mom and Dad's house just to check on her sometimes, and I could hear her having a full-blown prayer meeting at the top of her lungs, just going to beat the band, and you could stand there and listen to it, and it would go on for quite a while. And you know, you think, what entertains Grandma? Praise and worship, prayer. That entertained Nana. That was what she loved so much. She loved her husband so much. She loved her children so much. And, you know, I remember... Sorry. I don't even know why I planned to say this, because this is going to be a hard part. I remember when Brenna was quite sick in the hospital, and Mom said to me, I'm scared to tell Nana, because Nana lost a baby. And I remember Mom was so nervous about that. And when she told her, Nana grabbed her purse and jacket, and she flopped down in a chair in the hospital waiting room with barely a look on her face, and she just said, we need to pray and be strong for Brenna when she wakes up. And sure enough, as today, Brenna's healthy as could be sitting here, and I was a little blown away because we were all worried how Nana would react to that because of what she'd been through. But after everything she had been through, she sat down with faith, believing in God, and she had faith that God was going to cover her family. She knew that God, yes, her baby had went to be with Jesus, but that moment she had faith, and she sat there, and she said a quiet prayer. Her and Papa, they prayed. I remember that, and to this day, I'll never forget that. Many times over the years, Grandma and Grandpa both, their examples of prayer and faith were so instilled, and I'll never forget. I remember, you know, so many times just sitting over here and Nana sitting right behind me in church, hearing her, she had a way, she never said glory, she said glory, glory, never quite like glory. Papa would say it that way too. I don't know if it was from the South or whatever, but there's certain things I will just never forget. But the most core things, out of all the spoiling, all the good times, like Diana said, there was road trips. There was one time Nana says, well, I'm going to visit Shannon, California. I said, I want to go. So she bought a second ticket, and I went. And we went down to California to visit Shannon. Out of all those kind of things, as great as they were, as just who she was, the things I will remember the most, like Diana said, and so many others said, it was her faithfulness. And she suffered one of the worst, my worst fears of losing a child. But she was no less devout in her belief in Jesus, his faithfulness, that he was covering her. And out of all three of my grandparents, I can say they're some of the greatest Christians I ever met. They're some of the greatest Christians I will ever have known. They might not have some big fancy name. Not a lot of people will really ever remember Geraldine Wilkinson. But some of the things she did, some of the people's lives she influenced, some of the people she prayed for, those things will go on throughout history. And I'm very proud to say that she was my Nana.
Thank you, Andon. And before the great-grandchildren come to sing, Brother Shu, it would be meaningful to the family and the church family, then the years that you spent here. Would you come and just greet us today and anything that you would want to share briefly to this congregation, and the Shoes were here for 8 years, I believe, 8 years, and those were some fun years, some good years when Nana and Papa were here, so we'd love for you to come and just greet us and share today briefly, and then following that will be the great-grandchildren to sing as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Lance. I have nothing prepared. I had no idea. We just wanted to be here because Sister Wilkinson and her husband meant so much to us. Our time spent here in this church was really the time when we raised our children. We felt we raised our children here in Chilliwack. And what a precious couple. What a precious couple. I love to hear them singing. She had such a full, beautiful voice and such a compliment to her husband and everything that he did, and just a precious lady to know. And it's our privilege today just to be able to be here and to give honor to Sister Wilkinson. That's how we always knew her. Just felt I couldn't couldn't call her anything else because I respected her in that way. Just a beautiful lady of God. She reminded me very much of my own family, my mom and aunts, because they were all from Oklahoma. And as my brother Steve would say, they all had that same Oklahoma haircut. Wasn't cut at all. It was a hairdo is what he was talking about, those beautiful Pentecostal hairdos that they loved. And it was just so elegant. She was such an elegant, beautiful lady. She really was. And it really is just our privilege to be here. Thank you so much for allowing me to have a word today.
Your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Faithfulness sure seems to be the theme today. And to a God who has demonstrated such faithfulness to us, Word, there really is no greater calling on the life of any human being, especially one who has heard the gospel and responded to the gospel. There's no greater calling than the calling of faithfulness. And we're thankful today for the faithfulness of Nana. The next in our agenda needs no introduction, but I'm taking the moment to do so anyway. Pastor Dylan, pastor of this church where Nana attended for many years, was here from really the inception or the early years, and served faithfully in many different ways. I had the privilege of being here as well for 23 years, 24 years. And I'm thankful today for my father-in-law, for her son-in-law, for Pastor Dylan, to some today, the bishop, general or the superintendent of British Columbia, holds many offices and wears many hats. But in the last few years of Nana's life, he wore a new hat. And that was the hat of, in addition to others, of course, in the family and Tanya and others that helped, but really day to day, the caregiver, if you will, to Nana. And I had to sit by and wonder if God was going to call me to that same type of ministry. And I have to tell you, he set the bar really, really high. And so I'm just praying that the role is called up yonder well before I ever have to minister in that way to my mother-in-law. Maybe that's why we moved. I don't know. I don't know. But this is a point in the service where as it settles down after a comment, you'd hear a big sigh from the second pew. And I never really understood the sigh. It is generational. It has worked its way down. And I've never understood the sigh. I didn't know if I was in trouble. I did say some things I shouldn't have said, probably from this very pulpit. But there'd be that sigh, and I hadn't thought about it till this very moment, but just as it settled, that sigh would come. And I'm thankful for those little moments, those little memories. Each of you have your own unique ones, the family, personal family, the church family. There's those moments that will carry us over the next few days, weeks, months, and as we remember. But in this moment, Pastor Dylan, Dad, would you come and share what's on your heart today in this service?
Thank you, Lance, and praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. This is a wonderful time of sharing and honoring a life that has been so well lived among us, and yet if she was here, and perhaps she is, she would want to have church. She never did get into connect groups, or some of you call life groups. That wasn't her thing. We had church, and she always wanted to come to church. But thank you for being here. Wonderful for all of you to join in honor of her life, and all of those of you that have joined by the way of the web today. And we want to thank everyone that has been a part of this and are a part of this service today, honoring a wonderful lady. I first met them, of course, when I was a teenager and got interested in their daughter. And being a wise country boy, I quickly discerned that my way in was through my mother-in-law, who became my mother-in-law. And so I would bring her flowers and write her cards. And at the end of the card, I would always say, "Pass the butter, please," because she knew I was buttering her up. I was preparing the ground, and it worked. It worked. It was a unique and a special relationship, and when we first got married, I asked my wife, I said, "Well, what do I call them?" I call them Mom, Dad,
they were quite uncomfortable with that idea right at the first. So that's why it was James and Geraldine. But they, of course, were as much my parents as well. And we loved them dearly. And just so special to be connected to people with love and build relationship. You know, that's what this is all about. If we don't have relationship, we've got nothing. Everything else passes away. All of us in this room are connected in some measure, some way, and it's because of relationship that we have what we have today. And so I honor her and her life today, and I was thinking in this last year or two, whenever I was home, I put her to bed because she fussed less with me than anybody. As the dementia settled in on her life, she got a little combative and didn't want to behave sometimes. So she just didn't mess with me. And I don't know if it was because somewhere in the back of her mind, she thought, that's my pastor, I don't know. But somewhere along the line, she decided that she wasn't going to mess with me, so I could get her to bed easier. And often in those last months, especially when the fog was so heavy, I'd get her into bed, and then I'd lay my hand on her head and pray and watch the fog roll away and her begin to call upon the name of the Lord. And then she would settle down for sleep, maybe only 30 minutes, but she'd go to sleep. And then we'd probably repeat that sometimes. I confess, in the middle of the night, I didn't pray with her too much. I just said, Geraldine, you got to go back to bed. That's just all there is to it. And away she would go. So I have a few remarks, and because she would have liked this to be church, I'm going to speak to you out of the word of the Lord today. And if I can. This arises from a conversation with my doctor yesterday. And funny things happen, arise out of funny conversations and different things, but I just had a regular doctor's appointment and we squeezed it in and I got in there. And so I was just telling him at the end of our little session there that Geraldine had passed away, and because he had helped care for her during COVID when we couldn't get back across the border, and he was so kind in that regard and didn't charge anything for his own fees, and was just very helpful. And probably he deals with so many people, he probably is trying to place it in his mind, but he said, was she a believer? Because he is Christian as well. And and I said, yes, sir. She was a lifelong believer. And so out of that comes kind of maybe an unusual word from the Lord for this service today. But I want to read in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And it says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body of the dying of Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death worketh in us, but life in you. We having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed, therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore we speak. And I want to talk to us this morning about this particular passage of Scripture. Paul writes to the Corinthian church and to us all these years later that there is a particular treasure that we all possess. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. And the irony of it, while we think it is our life and it's all about us, the real purpose is that the excellency of the power of God may be declared and may be known in us, in these earthen vessels or these jars of clay, these fragile, breakable containers that possess and hold the most integral part of who we are, which is not our flesh. It is not the container. It is the Spirit, our Spirit, breathed into us by one breath of life from the very beginning. So powerful, that one breath, that today, every time a child is conceived, it is passed again to the next generation. Amen. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. I look at you. I recognize you. I know you by the earthen vessel, but he knows us much more intricately. And the treasure that we possess in these earthen vessels is not our bank accounts or our successes or our achievements or our talents or our abilities or anything of that nature. But the treasure that we possess is that essence, that soul, that spirit that lies resident in these earthen vessels. The treasure that is in you, not the physical that we spend so much time in. Man is a living soul, and because of the properties of God's breath, amen, we will experience eternal existence somewhere, but we will never die. When we understand that, so much more powerful is the words of Jesus when he said, "What shall it profit a man if he should gain the whole world and lose his own soul, lose the essence, that who you really are? What profit to it?" So this treasure that we are, this treasure that we possess within these earthen vessels, the earthen vessels become aged, they wax old, they begin to decay and fall backwards. If you don't believe that, did you look in the mirror this morning? Amen. Did you see what I see when I look in the mirror? It's not the 18-year-old or the 16-year-old or the 12-year-old boy. It's an aging, decaying vessel, but it contains that which is most important. It contains our spirit, our soul. And so in this passage of Scripture, very interesting, and I don't want to belabor it this morning, but when we get down to the 13th verse where we stop today, it says, "We having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed and therefore have I spoken, and we also believe and therefore speak." And so this passage of Scripture is and a very interesting passage of Scripture, because Paul now is pointing to his Bible. The Old Testament was their Bible. And he's going back to the Scripture and he is pulling up the words of the psalmist. What he is reciting comes to us from the package of psalms that were known as the Egyptian Hallel, which was recited in all three of their feasts as they would gather together, and sometimes even sung or chanted as a habit, even to this day, is used, particularly in the Passover, where they would chant these passages of Scriptures from Psalms 115 or 113 to 118. And it's interesting that the Egyptian Hallel, which celebrates the deliverance from Egypt and the removing themselves from bondage and so on, precedes the Psalms of Ascent, which start in 120 of the book of Psalms and moves forward. These are the psalms that they would sing and recite on their way to ascend to worship as they would go to the house of the Lord. And it's no, I don't think it's any coincidence that the Psalms of the Hallel precede the Psalms of Ascent, in that I believe that praise and thanksgiving always should precede the ascent to worship. This was what was being said. So he is quoting out of Psalms 116, verse 10. And this passage of Scripture, it was one that is recited over and over again in these most important, most solemn assemblies of the people of God. And out of this passage of Psalms 116, there are some things that I think are very important for us to consider at this particular moment. The psalm is a psalm of thanks. It's a psalm of giving thanksgiving and deliverance from Egypt, from the threat of death, from the threat of annihilation. It is the declaration of life. It is living before God. The passage of the Hallel precedes these psalms of ascent and is very important. And in this, amen, it is more than just a verbal acknowledgement. You know, the question often comes up, what is a believer? And in this conversation, this is what sparked my thinking as the doctor asked me, well, was she a believer? And the question is, what is a believer? I believe today that to be a believer is not a verbal assent only. Our modern day Christianity has failed to impress the truth of God's word, in that a believer is not just one who verbally assents to believing, but it's one who shows with their own life that which they believe, and they live with a statement that is according to that which they believe. A believer is one who declares what they believe with their life. It's a living testimony of life. It's the greatest declaration that we can make. It is a declaration of the will. It is a declaration of human choice that has been given to us. It is a declaration of absolute faith and a love in God. And so the scripture says, so we believe, and therefore, because we believe, we speak. We speak. What do we speak? With just words of assent, with just the shadow, an acknowledgement of a way of life? Or do we speak with our lives? Do we preach a message with our lives? Does our lives speak that of the human will and the choice and the belief in a God who is and is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him? What do we speak? So the psalmist in this 116th chapter of the book of Psalms makes some declarations that I would just like to leave with you this morning as we celebrate this life. And I believe that Sister Geraldine's life says these things. It spoke something. She was not a preacher per se, although if you were on her bench and you were a visitor, and as a church planner, I always tried to calm that down because I didn't want people run off before they could experience Jesus. But she would, I've heard her say to new people that walked in, have you been baptized in Jesus' name? Have you been filled with the Holy Ghost? So these declarations, I believe, and I'll just mention them briefly. The first propositional declaration of the psalmist He said, I will call upon the name of the Lord as long as I live. It's more than just a prayer. He's not talking about a set of words, something to be repeated. But when the scripture of the Old Testament talks about calling on the name of the Lord, it is talking about a life lived, a lifestyle. It is meaning that I have chosen Jehovah God and I have given my life to him and I will follow him. 116 verse 1 and 2, I love the Lord because he hath heard my voice and my supplications, because he hath inclined his ear unto me. Therefore will I call upon him as long as I live. Propositional declaration number 2, I will walk before the Lord while I live my life. Verse 8 and verse 9, for thou hast delivered my soul from death, mine eyes from tears, my feet from falling. I will walk before the Lord in the land of the living. A propositional declaration. I will walk before God in this life, in this earthen vessel, in this time span in which I have. Amen. The third declaration, I will take the cup of salvation. Verse 13 says, I will take the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. Amen. And I would suggest to you today, if you have never, amen, taken the cup of salvation that has been offered, Sister Geraldine would want you to know today that you ought to, amen, sip from the cup of salvation today. Amen. Amen. You ought to experience the death, burial, and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Because it is the very essence and source of life. Fourth declaration, I have made my vow and I will pay it. I will follow through with my life. My vows I will make in the presence of those who live around me. Verse 14, I will pay my vows unto the Lord now and in the presence of all his people. Amen. This is the life lived before God, paying that which has been vowed. Amen. We have said, many of us in this room today and those watching online, that, amen, I will serve the Lord. I will walk for the Lord. I will give my life to the Lord. Wherever God wants me to go, I will go. Whatever he wants me to do, I'll do. Whatever he wants me to say, I will say. And the psalmist said, I will pay those vows. And I won't wait till another day or another time, but I will pay those vows now and in the presence of his people. Amen. While I'm living this life in this earthen vessel, while I am in existence in what we call life here. Amen. And before I depart from it, here I will live for God. Here I will pay my vows. Here I will, amen, do that which I have committed myself to do. And finally, I will offer the sacrifice of thanksgiving. Verse 17 says, I will offer thee the sacrifice of thanksgiving, and I will, here it is again, call upon the name of the Lord. The wise man said, remember now thy creators in the days of thy youth, while the evil days come not, nor the years draw nigh, when thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. And she lived a long life. God blessed her. And she would say to me often, almost daily, I don't know why I have to live this way, when there were moments of clarity. And I would remind her of the blessings of the Lord, how good God's been to her. Amen. All the great things. And we would talk about some of those things. But there is a frame within this life in which we have the strength, the ability, and the opportunity to choose. And this is why the wise man says, remember your Creator in the days of your youth, while the evil days, those days of age and decay and growing old and infirm before that day happens. Thankfully, Sister Geraldine had done that. She remembered, amen, her Creator, while she could in her strength and her opportunity to choose, and she chose well, and she remained faithful. She committed herself to living a life before God. And so I think of the wise man poet as he writes in this 12th chapter of the book of Ecclesiastes. The imagery that he gives is so distinct to me. And he says in verse 6 and 7, or ever the silver cord be loosed, or the golden bowl be broken, or the pitcher be broken at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern. Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit, that which is contained in the earthen vessels, the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. And I think of the golden bowl, now tattered, worn, and broken. Beside the stream of life, the fountain of life, no longer able to contain and carry that precious element that was possessed within it. Amen. That treasure in the earthen vessel. And when the golden bowl became broken, the Bible says the silver cord was loosed. That invisible connection that holds the spirit to the body, that which is the essence of who you are, becomes severed. And for us to experience that means that we will be in the presence of eternity, in the presence, hopefully, of the Lord. Amen. So on October 31, that silver cord was loosed. And Sister Geraldine, whose golden bowl was broken and tattered and worn, could no longer contain the fountain of life, soared away into the presence of the Lord. Just recently I wrote, because I couldn't be there for the homegoing service of Sister Gloria, I said, with the same step that she stepped out of this life was the same step she stepped into the presence of God. Just a step. The silver cord was loose. The spirit left that golden bowl and now is in the presence of the Lord. Amen. We have this treasure. Yes. You have this treasure. Sister Geraldine would want you to know that your treasure is important and that you ought to make the most of your opportunity today. Praise God. And so we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the glory may be of God, not of ourselves, that God can be seen through our lives. Amen. What a beautiful thing it is to come to this point of your life and to know that your faithfulness has paid dividends. Your faithfulness has been rewarded. Amen. Amen. Oh, I just feel the presence of the Lord here today. I hope you feel God's presence today. Amen. And so, let me remind you the words of the wise man. Remember thou your Creator in the days while you can, in the days while you are able to, while God has given you the power of choice, while God has given you, amen, the strength to choose Him today. live your life for Jesus Christ. Amen. She lived her life for Jesus in her own way, in the simplicity of it, but with faithfulness and fervor and zeal. Amen. Thank God for lives lived, amen, for Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. I want my life to be lived for Jesus. Amen. I want my life to be lived for Him. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Amen. Why don't we stand together today? And we're grateful for the presence of the Lord that we feel in this service. And we're thankful for, I know many of you have traveled to get here today, and we're, on behalf of the family, we appreciate you being here. Sister Susan Hill and Cherish came all the way from Rio Grande, California, and many of you came from different places throughout the province, and we're just thankful that you're here. But we want to close in prayer, and I invite you to pray with me today. Lord Jesus, we are so thankful today. God, we're grateful for your sweet spirit that is here, that we have felt in this place today throughout this service. God, we're thankful for each one that's come here today to celebrate the life of Nana. Thankful for the example of her life that she lived in front of us, the example of a life well lived, Lord, the stories that we've heard today, the prayers that she prayed for many of us here in this room, her legacy, God, that remains here today. God, we're grateful and thankful today, Jesus, that you have allowed her to be connected to our lives, the blessing of the many memories of her life, Lord, that we can recall and remember today and in the days and weeks to come. God, and we pray today specifically for your peace, for your comfort, for your strength, God, that you would be among us, that you would be with us, Lord, for those of us that are left behind, God, that you would allow us to be comforted by your presence, by your spirit. Lord, that the power of the hope that we have, and we're so grateful, Lord, that we have hope in our lives. But God, that the power of hope would manifest in our hearts and in the minds of us who mourn here today. God, the psalmist said that our souls yearn for your salvation. But for those of us that live and remain, we can hope in your word. And we're so grateful for that today. Thank you for her life that inspires all of us to live with our lives fastened on you, looking towards you. And I pray, Lord, that we would continue to do that. Bless us today, we pray, and we ask all of these things in the name of Jesus. And everyone said amen.
Amen.
Amen. We have food and refreshments downstairs, and we invite all of you today to come down and spend some time together. Amen. God bless you today in Jesus' name.